Hello guys, it's the Dog Daddy. I'm here in Santa Monica about to start a brand new training session with a new dog that I haven't met before. I wanted to bring you guys along with me and show you some of the techniques I'm going to use. Again, I'm meeting these dogs on the spot. I really don't know what they need help with yet, but this is how I do it. Whatever the owners tell me they need help with is what I help them with. And they're about to pull up and you guys will get to see me in action.
At this point, you guys have seen a lot of my 1 minute long videos of the various aggressive and reactive dogs I work with. But I see that it is still a lot of confusion on how my methods work and what type of training this is, or what is really going on with these dogs and what am I trying to accomplish with them. And that's why I wanted to bring you guys today with this brand new training class that I'm about to do here in Santa Monica with a group of brand new dogs I have never met before. I'm going to explain to you guys how my methods work, why the dogs look so scared, and so much more in this video to make it easier for you guys to understand the type of dogs that I'm working with and why my methods are so important in order to be able to help them. I'm also going to explain why I choose to use the methods that I use. Although there are other methods of training, this should be a really good video. I hope you guys enjoy it and let me know what you guys think in the comments below. We're about to get started. The first dog I'm working with is this 10-month-old German Shepherd Labrador mix. He's got a good temperament, but he's just all over the place and needs a lot of guidance. He's also reactive towards other dogs.
All right, so the first thing that we need is something that allows us to communicate with him a little bit better. Because right now with the flat collar, as you can see, even if you are trying to correct him, it doesn't really tell him anything. So he continues to pull. And also you're not really using any type of technique to get his attention. So you're holding him back, you know? And so he's got nothing at all to even try to communicate with him. So this is just a leash in reverse. It's gonna look like a slip lead. But basically what it does restrict him a little bit more. So I'm able to apply a little bit of pressure. So I will go ahead and remove this leash. Let's walk him this way a little bit. Okay. So right now what I'm gonna do is I apply pressure already. I'm telling him I want him to stay right next to me on my left side, right? All right. So anything that he does now with lunging, pulling, barking, this pressure, but I also have to give him guidance. So I want him to stay right next to me, right there. When he gives me that, I have to release the tension. So you see me doing that really quickly. Now he's just sitting next to me. If he goes to pace, I restrict him with pressure. Now the thing is, when you enable them by not knowing how to correct and how to intervene, they keep practicing where they just kind of do whatever they in the moment, whatever comes up in the moment. You know, they don't have any boundaries, they don't look back, they don't have to listen to anything. So what I'm doing here is teaching him, if he just stays next to me, this is what I want. There's basically no tension on the leash, right? If he sees anything that gets his attention and thinks he can just lunge towards them, again, when I do this here, you can see his entire body language is responding. It's like, what do you want from me, you know? He's not even doing anything wrong, but you see he became even more submissive. Calm and submissive, not in a bad way, but he's more relaxed. If you just let them pace around, they get carried away with that, and it becomes a compulsive behavior. So all the way from pacing, to jumping, to the pulling, to barking, it's all the same thing. They cannot stop themselves. So the pressure, right there, you can tell every time I do this, he communicates with him. Now if you start creating structure away from big distractions, see like when he does this here, no, sit, come, sit, good, and then release. Everything is done calm, but the right way to be able to give him directions. What I was going to say is, when you don't do this from the beginning, when you don't do this like from the moment you get out of the house, before they see a dog, you just let them go and you don't do anything, it's a lot harder when you go to do it right here in the moment. Because now he doesn't expect that anything can stop him. He's a great dog with great temperament, he's very stable, he just needs directions. But even then, he's gonna choke himself out before he listens. You know, because he sees a dog, he thinks he can just go and do it. So you can tell he's, at first it's a little new, and he kind of doesn't understand that he needs to stop with the pressure. Meaning he goes a little bit further than he's gonna be going in just like a couple minutes. Because right now, he's learning. See, he tried to lay down, I communicated with him to stay sitting. by doing a little bit of pressure. So everything is through pressure and leash guidance, using the leash to guide him. Now, he's doing pretty good. He's sitting next to me. There's no tension on the leash. I hold it where it's quick for me to apply pressure if I need to. If it goes to pace right now, I'll be able to do this. But since he's not, there's no tension on the leash. Because every time he feels tension, he should know that we want something from him. We're looking for some type of behavior. We're trying to get him to stop what he's doing. See, I don't even give him that chance to be in the front of the leash. I can tell. It can be hard at first, but I'm gonna keep him right here. And as soon as he relaxes even a little bit, he can tell there's no tension on the leash anymore. He lunges, I pull him back. He's still positioning right next to me every time. Hey, sit. Good boy. And that's really tempting right there. He's controlling himself.
I am switching the 10-month-old pup to a prong collar. The reason I'm doing this is that the prong collar is actually a great tool to help communicate with the dog through the leash. It's not a tool to dominate the dog and just, you know, forcefully control them. It's great at giving the dog directions, and it's so much easier for the dog to understand. When you see how I use this collar in person, you'd be amazed on how the dog just quickly responds to it and is able to take signals through the leash to know exactly what we want from them. It is also a great tool to teach boundaries and limitations, because of course the dog does feel the sensation of the collar, and what we're teaching them is when they feel any type of tension on the leash, they should respond accordingly instead of fighting it. When a dog has a flat collar or a harness, they lean on it, they apply force against the pressure, and they will choke themselves out. They will literally hurt themselves before they ever respond to that type of pressure. But with the prong collar, it delivers a sensation around the dog's neck, which just gets their attention and helps them understand what we're trying to communicate with them. Of course, it is just a tool. There's also techniques that I use with the prong collar to help communicate with the dog, and that's what I teach my clients. You can teach your dog to go into a heel position much quicker. You can create engagement with the prong collar. You can reinforce a sit very effectively and safely. And again, the dogs just pick up so quickly that there's no denying that the collar is amazing at communicating with the dog. But I have to emphasize that it is not just throwing a prong collar on your dog that will do the trick. You have to learn how to use the prong collar properly. Also, a lot of my clients will leave my classes with completely different types of prong collars. There's different brands, and some brands are better for some dogs than others. So it's really important to understand your particular dog and what collar would be best for them. Also, not every dog I train I recommend a prong collar for, even though for most dogs it is going to be the one tool that I'm going to recommend, but that doesn't mean it's for every dog. In this particular training here, at least two of the dogs did not use a prong collar, and I advise them to not use one.
If you don't do anything to begin with, like I said, to establish, like this here, a dog is coming, you want to start before he's already lunging. If you wait too long, he's gonna lunge, and then he's gonna feel too much tension on the collar. He's gonna jump up and down screaming. And then if you don't release and you keep holding up, he's gonna panic even more. Okay. Every time you're going to communicate with him, you start with signaling to him first. For example, if a dog is coming and you want him to move this way, you don't just pull him off, because his mind is over there and he's gonna feel all that tension. So instead, you say, you do like, come. And then if he doesn't respond, you slowly start to apply pressure and then increase it until he responds.
Okay.
All right. Keep him a little bit away from the other dogs right now, and just establish, like, give him directions first. And when I come back around, we'll bring dogs closer to him.
Okay.
I would recommend the left side. If you want to do the right side, it's okay. But be consistent with one side. Whatever side you choose, we're going to reinforce his dad all the time.
Okay.
It makes it easier for him and for you. And once you establish this, like in 1 month, and you open the dog, you go for a walk, he wants to position himself next to you.
Yeah.
Hello, guys.
Hi.
All right, so I see your dog reacting with dogs and people. Okay, and she's five?
She wants to bite everything.
Yeah, how long have you had her?
4 or 5 years.
5 years, okay.
I've really been walking her for about a month or
yeah,
two.
Yeah, he's helping me with her. Because,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's, yeah. So she's more like reactive, right, with like new people, new dogs? Okay.
Yeah, her tail's wagging, but you never know.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's just excitement. But if you want her to not be reactive when you're out in public at any time, any moment, it's a matter of you getting control over the situation. So that's what we're going to do today. Let's see what here.
So this is the moment where you guys start to see the dog act really scared and confused, pulling away. They look completely petrified of what's going on. And this can be very hard to watch if you love your dog and you see this happening to a dog and you don't really understand why or the need to use this approach. So I'm going to explain to you guys why this is so important and also why it's really not that big of a deal. Basically getting you to understand what is going through the dog's mind at this time. Let's start by saying that this dog is a 5-year-old dog. The owner has had him for 4.5 years, and he has basically never been approached by anyone because he's super overprotective and he shows aggression, and so no one has ever been able to get too close to him or his owner, let alone pet him or handle him on the leash. So since I'm the first person to ever hold on to the leash and try to pull him away from his owner, he will throw a fit. It's completely expectable that a dog like this will fight because they really have been enabled and they don't think that anyone could ever approach them because they have successfully scared everybody away by showing aggression. Over time, these dogs become really confident that that is the only way to scare people away, and they also continue to think that it is necessary for them to scare people away in order for them to stay safe, because obviously this is coming out of fear, and so they feel like they need to protect themselves, and therefore they become defensive, show aggression, people don't approach them, don't want to pull them away from people, and over time they become more and more aggressive and more of a danger. So with just dogs that have been enabled for so long, the only way to help them is by putting them through their fear. As you guys can see here, a couple minutes have gone by and the dog is now starting to lean towards me. He has realized that I'm not going to give up like most people do and let him scare me away from him, or let him pull away from me. Letting him pull away from me and avoid me would continue to allow him to live with this mentality that he either has to defend himself or run away, which is literally the two options that he thinks he has. Now, I'm giving him a third alternative, which is to give in to the pressure, trust the handler holding the leash, and starts to realize that he's safe, because once he gives up with that aggression and the pulling away, you guys can see that I'm very calm and welcoming. I'm rewarding him. I'm using positive methods to encourage engagement and build a relationship with the dog. So this really gives them this third alternative. And the dogs really quickly choose to go that direction because it's the best and the most comfortable for them. Once the dog is at this level, the only thing you see him here now being a little bit anxious is because he's away from his owner. But look at the difference from when he was showing aggression to then completely panicking when I was holding the leash. Those things will never happen again with me handling him. After that one little bit of training to get him to give in to the pressure, that's why it's so important, because now you see a dog that has been enabled for over 4 years, completely different on the leash. Now, from this point on, I'm representing the owner. I have already established to the dog that they have to behave a certain way with me, and that allows me to now represent the owner, meaning any new person or dog or anything that would normally trigger him to become defensive, he now is learning that he can no longer do that. And you see me doing here is applying pressure to indicate to the dog I do not want them to worry about people coming towards us, and not giving them that chance or that option to be defensive. And then at the same time, creating a good experience around those triggers, those things that were originally a trigger, whether it's a person like here, you know, he can tell he's really uncomfortable, but I'm not allowing him to show aggression. I'm also not allowing him to back away and try to run away. You can tell when he tries to move and pace around, I restrict him with pressure and I put him through walking between just people here, because previously he would just not allow you to do that. Also, when I say I don't allow the dog to show aggression, a lot of people think that this will turn the dog into a taking time bomb. But actually what that means to me is that I'm not allowing the dog to be in an aggressive state of mind. So I'm not just correcting the dog for showing obvious signs of aggression, such as growling, barking, snapping, showing teeth. I'm also correcting them for just the thought of being aggressive. Now, this is not for anyone to do. This is not for someone who doesn't know how to read a dog's body language, because it's a very precise thing to do. But I'm redirecting and correcting the dog every time they even think about showing any type of aggression or using aggression as a way to get away with what they want to get away with, whether they're trying to not let you pet them or they are trying to scare you away from them. And just the moment they think that, I will redirect the dog. When I do this, the dog will naturally start to look for an alternative, and the alternative is to be calm and submissive. Once they choose the alternative to be calm and submissive, I then have no need to apply any more pressure. I am then using only positive reinforcement and also just really calm energy that makes the dog feel safe around me and therefore establish trust. And so now I will have a dog that not only respects me but also trusts me. This is another great example on how the pressure works to get your dog under control. And I'm going to explain to you guys why in the beginning you guys are going to see I had to use a lot more pressure and then quickly reduce the amount of pressure that was required for me to get this dog's attention. Now pay attention, because this part is going to be extremely important. So to start, this is another 5-year-old dog that has been only trained with positive reinforcement. She has a great temperament, but she is completely out of control, extremely powerful, and being enabled for 5 years. She's been trained with a harness and positive reinforcement only. She will warm up to people when you give her food and treats and whatever to try to get her to like you. But as you can see, that does not solve the root of the problem, which is a dog that does not have boundaries. She does not have respect for the handler. She thinks she can just get whatever she wants, and she uses force to get that. Now that I started to use pressure, you see the dog quickly choosing to listen, because now they know there's a consequence for their actions. So no longer they are yanking people's arms, dislocating their arms, and instead you can see here how much control I have over her. Even after I stop applying pressure, I release, and now I'm basically training the dog's mind to that when I say something, they want to listen. She had dogs barking at her, and she chose to sit there even though there was no tension on the leash. Once she did that for a little bit, I walk her away. Keeping in mind, this is all happening like in the moment. This is only literally minutes into the training after I took over the leash. This dog is going to continue to improve greatly as we go along, and you guys are going to see that through this video. And this is all in one training session, but now with the right tools and the right technique and changing the dog's mentality, this is going to permanently change her habits and her ways. Now, a lot of people may say, of course she's listening because we are applying pressure, there's tension on the leash. You know, some people will exaggerate and say we are hurting the dog and choking the dog, which is not true. There's enough pressure just to get their attention. But the alternative to that is to have a dog the way that she was before. Every other method, the common methods that you guys see people suggesting, has been used for these dogs here. And as you can see, years go by and they are just more enabled, more out of control. And look how quickly you can solve the problem by using the methods that I use. Now, keeping in mind that if she was trained from the beginning using my methods, she would never have gotten to the level that she was when she came for my training to begin with. She would have grown up understanding the right from the wrong, and the amount of pressure that you guys saw that it was necessary in the beginning would never have been necessary had her started the training with my methods from a young age. Just because I'm strict with the dog and don't allow them to be all over the place, pacing, sniffing everything, doesn't mean that the dogs don't get to live a happy life. I'm just teaching them that there's the right time and place for them to do those things, and there's a time and place where they just have to behave. It's no different when your kids go to school and they have to sit in a chair and they're not allowed to be running around and playing, which kids like to do and we should allow them to do. But again, there's the right time and place for that.
Let me just see him. You can let go. Let go. Alright, so do the same thing. Stay from that side. And then walk this way. So right now. Alright. So with him, I did a different technique right there just to get his attention a little bit. And you can tell he got frustrated. And he tried to jump at me. That's completely normal. It's just because it's something that really gets his attention. So when I start to do that, he's going to get mad because it gets his attention. But then at the same time, sit. He's going to pay more attention. So I only have to do that a couple times and he's going to change. All right, go ahead and walk by. Leave it. Leave it. And then we can walk by. Come. Sit. Go by one more time, if you don't mind. I'm gonna be on top of him. I'm letting him. Hey, sit. Leave it. Leave it. And then release when he's good. Come. Come on. Good boy. And I haven't changed any of the tools or anything. I'm just using what you're using. But there was two things that I did, you know, obviously the pressure. Anything, even this here, see the dogs, they can get mad at first because it gets their attention. But, come here. That won't make him hate me or afraid of me or anything. I can balance it out really easily. But the technique is really effective to get his attention so I can get him, have him under control. Because even a dog like him, he already has some training. He just chooses to ignore you because you're not able to reinforce it. So now with the little technique, I can get him to respond and then I don't have to do it again. And I still have him under control. Now I'm gonna see a different dog walk by. Come. Sit. Yes, that's a good boy. Sit. Yes. Let me see his leash. Then I'm gonna try to walk them slowly that way. Come. Good boy. You have to learn to understand your dog's personality and what triggers them, you know, their weaknesses and their strengths. So, for example, with him, he's only 10 months. So, and he is like kind of getting away with things and he's not very mature. With him, he's actually very confident, very stable. It's part of the breed and also being a male, and his age right now is where he's gonna want to stand his ground. So So anything that happens, it feels like he needs to get involved. Even though he's actually very confident, as long as there's nothing going on, it's more when a dog gets too close to him, one, because he already just learned to be reactive. But once he's already settled down, the only thing that triggers him again is when a dog is unstable. Now, he's really easy to redirect, because you see, every time he did that, even though I had both dogs, I go here and I do this, and he gets his attention, right? So he can redirect him. But it's really important that you're on top of it. Every time you hear something, he's gonna get involved. He's gonna wanna get involved. So that's what I told you from the beginning before I even handled him. It's a matter of teaching him self-control. So if I do, hey, sit. We're gonna practice with like sit and stay and hold a sit and stay. So it doesn't matter if a dog is playing over there, fighting over there, people are throwing ball, whatever it may be that he gets excited with, he's gonna stay. You can use yourself where you're like moving around him, make sure that he can stay. And you're gonna have to reinforce it with pressure. It's very important. If you're reinforcing it by just like making him repeat that, most dogs, they can do it 100 times and they're not gonna see anything as a consequence. So they're willing to do it 110 times and 200 times, and you're gonna get tired before them. So, but when you do it with pressure, it doesn't have to be harsh, but that becomes a consequence. It's uncomfortable, it's annoying. But for example, right now, he's in a sit. So I just expect him to stay there, and you're gonna see that I'm gonna use myself as a distraction. When he moves, immediately you come with the pressure, no, sit, and then you go back to doing the same thing. So now notice how I, same thing there, sit. See how I go back to him? You wanna stay on top of that, and if he keeps persisting, you're gonna reinforce with that pressure, no, sit. And then we're gonna continue to practice this. Much better. Then you'll be with him. Good boy. And we'll try it again. Sit. Yes. Good boy. Okay, come. Then we release. That's only like the first time you can tell he couldn't stay with me walking around away. Then quickly he learned by just reinforcing basically just one time. With the pressure, the second time, I can go there and just say, psh, hey, this here, when I do the pressure, I always do like, hey, no, psh, all these sounds, because I can use these things to reinforce using just verbal command later on. So let's say he becomes really good with a sit and stay, and I move away and he starts to think that he can move away. From there, I can be like, uh-uh, and he goes back to a sit. Because he already associates the next thing is me running here and reinforcing with a leash. You gotta be very on top of that and really like strict with that. You know, you don't wanna say, no, stay, stay, stay. And then he moves and like, okay. Every time you let him do that, he doesn't have a total command like that is really meaningful. And this is important for this particular dog because you want him to be able to handle any situation. Now, other commands that are really gonna be very important for him is when you say leave it or walk or come. So, can you see? Like, see the moment here that I hold the leash, because you just hold your energy. Think about it this way: with this dog, you're holding him like this, so he feels all that tension. He gets really nervous because you're nervous, right? Which is normal. It's normal because you don't know how what type of dog you have. Like, as far as what is he gonna do? How do I stop him? How do I communicate with him? So the moment that I just grab the leash here, I don't even have to do anything. The dog already responds. So when I go, and I'm gonna show you how to do the same thing, so don't worry. But it's all a matter of understanding the dog, right? That's the most important thing. When you understand them and you know how to communicate with them, the dog already senses that. If they pay attention to my energy and they see that it's calm, they feel calmer as well. So I'm gonna walk by, you can stay there. Come. Come. Sit.
Good boy.
Come. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and switch to something that just allows us to communicate with him a little bit better. Because even though he's responding, but it's really hard to actually like communicate with him with the harness. Okay. Perfect, good boy. And then same thing back this way. Come. Sit. Leave it. Yeah, so what you wanna do, first thing that you're doing wrong is that you're holding the leash way far on the top. You know, so when he lays down like this, because don't do anything yet, when he lays down like this, he's using this as an avoidance. It's a way for him to get away from having to listen. And when you pull up, he's going to be choking himself. So instead, you go forward, and when he's there, you want to hold the leash over there and have your arms all the way down. you know. So you hold, see how I'm holding firmly, basically like this. There's no tension, but if I'm doing this here and he pulls that way, it's so much harder for you to move your arm like this. And the dog is yanking that way, you know what I mean? So if it's down here, the moment he's even trying to turn that way, I'm gonna put my leg there and I'm gonna hold him here. So he can't turn that way. You wanna make sure that you reinforce and restrict the dogs because they learn to give in and instead of fighting it. Every time they fight the pressure, which is what they do when they don't have the right tools on, like a harness or even a flat collar, they're fighting the pressure. They feel all the tension, but they kind of try to pull through it, you know? And so you're throwing commands in there and he's ignoring everything, going through everything. So what this does, again, is creating restriction. So he learns to have more self-control. Every dog, they will learn to have more self-control. If a dog is barking even behind them, they learn that they don't have to turn around and defend themselves. We restricted them, but we also kept them safe. So now they can tolerate more and they become more comfortable. But, you know, it's so important to do this, otherwise they are going to be defensive. They're going to turn around and be defensive. So it's really important to restrict them. And that's why you want to have yourself positioned in a way that you're prepared for that. Basically, anything that happens right now, I'm prepared for with this dog. If a dog comes running off leash, I'm going to do this. My dog is already safe right away. And if the dog is barking at him, I will be able to be turning my dog around like this, really, really easily, you know what I mean? So if someone comes from behind, he's not going to have a chance to turn around.
Lastly, we have this one-year-old fearful German Shepherd that has become fear aggressive. And so her owner has to keep her away from people and other dogs. She's very reactive and won't let anyone near her. Now she's extremely fearful, and I'm going to explain to you guys again my methods here. As you can see, the dog panics whenever she feels pressure because she's used to being able to use aggression to scare the threats away, things that she sees as a threat. Now, I'm very confident. I go there and I grab her leash and I pull her away from her owner. You can tell she's very sensitive to the touch. That's why I do it very cautiously, because these dogs, even though it's out of fear, they still will show aggression and they will bite if given a chance. So I try to desensitize her to the touch very gently to avoid a bite. I try not to use a muzzle on a dog unless it is really necessary. So with this dog, you're going to see how she starts to give in to the pressure and start to move along with it. I think it's important to point out that when I do this type of training, my goal is not to just get the dog to like me. Because a lot of trainers, they will use positive reinforcement to prove a point that the dog warms up to them. But as you can tell, I'm doing this training out in public with a whole lot of distractions. Every single person here, this dog would be lunging and barking at. Every dog here, she was lunging and barking at before I was handling the leash. So what I'm doing here is establishing that it does not matter where we go. Right from the get-go, the dog is under control. Again, as I explained before, we are no longer allowing her to show aggression in order to scare her fears away from her. I wouldn't use the methods that I use if they weren't extremely effective and worked quickly. Now, why is it important to point out that it works quickly? It's because we're solving major anxiety and issues, not only with the dogs, but also with the owners, as well as other problems that come with allowing the dogs to behave the way they were behaving before, because these people have real lives. They can't take these dogs anywhere. They can't have people come over to their house. They can't take the dogs to the vet. There's so many issues that come with allowing the dogs to live in that mentality that they had when they came to the training. I have trained thousands of dogs with my methods, and I know it works in the long run. If it didn't work, everything that the haters say would make sense, but because it works, it does not traumatize the dog. It does not cause any long-term side effect. The dogs are still happy, even with me, who was the one that corrected them, and they didn't even know me before. As you can tell, at the end of the training session, even though this is in one training session, all the dogs are extremely happy, they're comfortable, but they're still under control. As you can tell, new distractions have come around, new people and new dogs are still around us, and the dogs are all still obedient. And they're only going to get better, because today we only established the foundation of the training. The owners are still going to continue to reinforce this. Alright guys, thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, follow me on Instagram, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Love y'all!